Good evening, YouTube. Welcome to The Truth According to Lily. I am your host, Lily, and tonight we are going to be talking about something that's not Star Trek related, but that is very relevant to what is going on in Hollywood today. So Inside Daisy Clover is one of my all-time favorite older movies. It came out in 1965. It has Natalie Wood, Christopher Plummer, a young Robert Redford, everybody. It also has Ruth Gordon in it, which she was a very well-known character actress in her time, and just always delivered on her performances, in my opinion. And a young Roddy McDowall. Also, if you don't know who he is, then you had a deprived childhood. Most people who are like my parents' age will probably know who I'm talking about when I'm talking about this movie, and I've said talking way too many times. So let's move on, shall we? It has a 6.3 on IMDb, which, as a lover of this film, I think is totally wrong and terrible, and it should be at least a 7.0, but whatever, no one asked me to be a consultant on IMDb or to just make reviews. Actually, I probably could if I created an account with IMDb, but I haven't ever. Don't really need to. So Inside Daisy Clover is about a young girl who's 15 and she is a tomboy, really loud, and really says everything that she's thinking, doesn't really care whose feelings she hurts because, again, she's 15. She's played by Natalie Wood. Well, she can sing. She's been sending her records to a production company, Swan Productions, which I was just like, oh my god, that was less like, it was so good. There's just so many great things about this movie. So she gets discovered by the producer, Raymond Swan, and his wife, Melora. It's not a menorah, wow. Melora. And they're just like, from the word go, they're weird. Just fucking weird. What's so wonderful, or one of the wonderful things about this movie, is how it is filmed. One of the first times Daisy is actually inside the studio, at the office, on the grounds of the back lot, is immediately, she is just completely doused in light. Like they turn these bright lights on her to see her face, to see every single minute detail that could be wrong with her or that could be good for her. But the producer, his wife, his associates, anyone who really works in the studio is pretty much always cloaked in darkness. You don't really see their faces right away, and it's this kind of men in the shadows type of deal. And then when she's actually in the studio offices or whatever, one of the first shots you see of her, the first time she's in this beautiful, pristine white house or office, whatever, it's through bars. You literally see her already locked in, caged in. She's already pacing like a fucking animal. She's taken away from her mother because her mother is batshit fucking crazy and put into the custody and entrapment of her money-grubbing older sister. So her freedom is immediately taken away because she had great freedom with her mother. Her mother was batshit crazy, but they had a pretty sustainable bond, you know? They're crazy. Each other's crazy matched the other one's crazy. So immediately her freedom is taken away. She's isolated from everything she's ever known. She's incredibly naive when it comes to the world of men, and they all immediately start taking advantage of every single facet she has to offer. Her mind, her talent, her body, her naivety, and her innocence is corrupted literally within weeks, and it's traumatic and awful. Now, what is this beginning to sound like, ladies and gentlemen? This movie was made in 1965, and prior to that, prior to the 40, 50 plus years that had already been that Hollywood had already really been around, or maybe I'm inflating those numbers a little bit, but prior to that, the casting couch mentality among producers, amongst studios, amongst directors, amongst even other actors was already an insidious part of the industry. And seeing it portrayed in a film made in 1965 just further reestablishes how relevant this topic is today. And I think if you're very passionate about what's going on in Hollywood today, if you've been following it, if you've been reading the articles, or trying to see both sides of the equation, I think you should definitely watch this film. I appreciate it even more. There are no good guys in this movie. There are no there are no righteous men. Even Robert Redford's character, who he himself is a cynic who has already been taken advantage of by the studio, who is being used and abused, and he knows his time will eventually come. I mean, he's a young man, but he knows his time is coming, dear heart. He completely, just totally takes advantage of Daisy Clover, Natalie Wood's character. He offers her the promise of true love. He uses her up, runs away, goes off and parties and fucks a bunch of men and women, comes back with a bunch of postcards he never mailed to her. And she asks him, like, why the fuck didn't you mail these? We had hot sex on your boat, and then you just took off. Oh, by the way, she's 15 again. And, well, at this point, she's 16. There you go. So that's okay, right? So at this point, she's 16, and she's basically just like, bro, why the fuck did you just run off and stuff like that? He doesn't even, like, have an excuse. Straight up, doesn't even fucking have an excuse. He's like, well, I'm back, so doesn't that make up for everything? I was nice to your mom, who the producers threw into a sanitarium. And that's the thing, like, you can't trust anybody in this movie. There is not a single righteous person in this entire movie. Even the producer's wife, Melora, who you think probably has better interests at heart for Daisy. Nope. Totally doesn't. In fact, she's entirely jealous of her. She hates her husband. She hates her life. She hates herself. This movie also has a amazing scene with Melora and Daisy after Daisy is left by her husband, who she eventually marries Robert Redford, but then he leaves her the day after they get married because he only married her to piss off Christopher Plummer's character. And the only reason he married her because he was fucking jailbait. Literally, he was fucking her and she's jailbait. What you later find out in this really, really dramatic, well-acted scene with Melora and Daisy is the revelation that Wade Lewis, Daisy's runoff husband, uses men and women to his advantage. He takes advantage of them. He uses them up. He throws them out. He used Melora. He slept with her. He had an affair with her. And when he left her, she literally admits to trying to kill herself. And then she also admits that she likes to cut herself. So this film not only sheds light on the horrible atrocities that have been going on in Hollywood since the beginning of Hollywood, since even going back further than that, you know, do you want to be a star mentality that people in power use to take advantage of innocence or even of each other? This movie sheds a light also on self-abuse. Melora is a self-harming, broken woman. You see that in this scene. She's hopped up on pills and drugs and alcohol, and she's gonna try and probably kill herself again, and she's saying all these horrible things to Daisy, and it's just, it's a beautiful fucking scene. It's so beautifully tragic that you see, wow, Daisy, this is the road you are fucking on, and you need to figure out how to get off. You need to just figure out how to get the fuck out. And the twisted fucked up thing is, because Daisy is a minor and she can't legally speak for herself, her sister just keeps re-signing her contract to Swan Studios. So she's gonna have to literally wait until she's 18 to have any legal power, any legal control whatsoever. And meanwhile, this studio and her sister are squelching all of the money they can out of her in the meantime. Daisy's nervous breakdown, which kind of begins to happen around the second act, and then finally culminates in this horrible fucking breakdown she has, was so well acted by Natalie Wood. I was just absolutely blown away. Again, I appreciate the performances and the story and the commentary that it was trying to convey even more now as an adult, especially with what has been going on in Hollywood right now. I think it's an incredibly relevant film because you not only see the predatory behavior that is inflicted upon Daisy, you see what it's done to Wade Lewis, who is Robert Redford's character, and what it's turned him into. This cynic who is becoming what he hates. He's embracing what he hates. He totally is. He's embracing that is what he has become, and that is who he is going to probably just stay until he just fades into obscurity. So you see both sides of the scale, both ends of the pendulum, and Daisy can't trust anyone. It's a great film, and I wish more people liked it. I wish more people talked about it and could see could appreciate its relevance a little bit more. I don't think people wanted to when it came out. I think people are having a harder time now that they're looking back and saying, wow, this was here a long time ago. What's even, I mean, not funnier, what's even more interesting is that the movie came out in 1965, but it was taking place in 1936. So at the beginning of Hollywood really cranking out their movie stars, Clark Gable, Tyrone Power, Myrna Loy, Marlene Dietrich, Humphrey Bogart, you know, Lauren Bacall, John Wayne, Maureen O'Hara. That's when this movie is taking place, literally in the golden age of cinema. The silver screen that literally just fed these promises. Spoon-fed these promises to these young star wannabes and just took advantage of them. And in one of the last scenes of the film, after Daisy's nervous breakdown, when you think that this producer's really willing to go through hell to make sure that he gets what he's invested out of Daisy, because that's all she is in the end. She's purely just an investment to him, nothing more. And the final scene that they're in together, oh my god, Christopher Plummer has never been more evil to me in a film. He is just at his peak of being a brutal, selfish motherfucker. Oh my god, it's so, so rough, so uncomfortable, and he fucking delivers, and it's so, so amazing, and he's so chilling in it, and Natalie Wood is just lying there, and she has to just fucking listen to it. And after he leaves, she makes her decision. And the ending is just, it's darkly humorous, the way the film ends. The film ends with, you know, finally there's this final confrontation between Daisy and the producer. She's tried to put her foot down. He won't let her. Says, basically, this is the way it is. You're an investment. I'm going to get all I can from you. And when I'm done, I'm cutting you loose because there's a million more where you came from, kid. So he leaves. He dismisses her nurse. Daisy gets out of bed. She's finally getting out of bed because she's been pretty much catatonic for the last, like, 15, 20 minutes. She notices that the nurse left the stove on, and it's a gas stove. She's like, fucking nurse, basically. Turns the stove off. And she's like, She opens the stove, or the oven, turns the gas on, and sticks her head in. The phone rings. The phone rings again, and again, and again. She's growing more and more frustrated. She's like, oh, what the fuck? So she turns off the gas. She goes and picks the phone up off the receiver, puts it down. She goes back, sticks her head in the oven. She starts inhaling the gas. The doorbell rings. She's like, what the fuck? Well, I have to answer the door because if I don't, it's going to be weird and they're going to walk in and catch me trying to kill myself. She turns off the oven. She closes the oven. She goes and answers the door. It's the fucking nurse. The nurse forgot her book. Daisy sits on the couch and she's lighting a cigarette and she's just sitting there like just waiting for this fucking nurse to find her book and get the fuck out so she can fucking kill herself. Meanwhile, you see a shot of the nurse and she sees that the phone is off, the telephone is off the receiver. So she's like, that's weird. So she hangs it back up. She goes back out. She's found her book. She's like, oh, Miss Clover, my sister's your biggest fan, blah, blah, blah. And Daisy's kind of like, give me the fucking pen. She signs the book. The nurse leaves. Daisy stubs out her cigarette. She goes back in the kitchen, turns on the gas, pulls up a chair, sticks her head in the fucking oven. Starts inhaling the fumes again. You know, she's ready. You know, this is how she wants to go. She's pissed off, but she wants to go. The telephone rings again. And I was laughing. I was laughing so hard. I'm like, this fucking would happen. This would totally happen. She gets up. She takes the phone off the receiver. And it's Roddy McDowall's character, who basically plays Christopher Plummer's little henchman. And you hear his voice over the telephone. He's just like, Miss Clover, Mr. Swan is going to see you at 7 tonight. That's my best Roddy McDowall impression. Which, by the way, isn't that far off. It's actually pretty good. That might be my best impression of anyone. Daisy ignores it. She goes back in the kitchen, turns on the gas. The stove's not working. She's starting to run out of gas because she's been turning it off and on and off and on. So she's like, what the fuck? So she slams the fucking stove door, the oven door a few times. Just like in anger, just slams it. She's like, what the fuck? This would happen. Then Daisy decides she doesn't have to literally kill herself. She just needs to disappear. She just needs to buy herself enough time. Turns the rest of the gas on. She gets dressed. She gets her shoes. She gets her pack of cigarettes. She tucks them into her pants. She turns the rest of the gas on. Turns on the oven. Turns on the stove. And leaves. And as she's walking away, she's got a cup of coffee. That's all she's got. She's got her cigarettes, her shoes, and a cup of coffee. She's walking away, and behind Natalie Wood, all you see on this beautiful beach is this giant fucking explosion. And I was like, that's my girl. That's my fucking girl. And it's such a fucking awesome ending, and it's so poetic. She doesn't go back to the studio, she just goes back to being regular Daisy Clover. She takes this horrible experience and she fucking burns it to the ground, and she's gonna start fresh and she's gonna start new. And it's this beautiful, like, rebirth in a way, because she tries to kill herself, but she keeps stopping because she's answering the phone, she's answering the doors because she really doesn't want to, because she knows that that is not the way she needs to go or the way she should go. It should be on her terms, but it should be the way Daisy Clover would fucking do it. So you just see this epic explosion, this beach house blows up, and she's just smiling, walking away. A fisherman, like, says something. It's like, "Miss, what the fuck just happened? What's going on? Is anyone in there?" kind of a thing. She just keeps smiling, and she keeps walking. Great ending, in my opinion, because she takes the last 3 years of her life and she literally lets it go up in a fucking burning haze of fire. Literally, everyone in this movie, kind of with the exception of her mother, is a raging piece of shit. No one is good to her. No one treats her well. No one has her best interests at heart. They literally use up Daisy Clover as much as they fucking can. And again, I know I've said it 100 times already in this video, this movie is so fucking relevant to what's going on today. To the predatory behavior that is in Hollywood on both sides of the aisle. The hypocrisy of it, the bullshit of it, and yet we still, you know, throw our money at film. I do. I'm a hypocrite in that regard. I can openly admit that I am a hypocrite because I still love films. I still love storytelling. And I think that there are some good-hearted people out there in that industry, but honestly, I'm a cynic in the sense that I think the predators outweigh the righteous men and women. So, as far as social relevance goes, watch this fucking movie. Watch it. I don't care if you don't like old movies. I don't care if you think that they're cheesy and corny and bullshit and poorly acted. Older movies are some of the most well-acted films you'll ever come across. It is a style of acting that is completely lost. It is in very few actors of today. There are very few actors of today who I could picture standing on the same level as Humphrey Bogart and Gary Cooper and John Wayne, even Laurence Olivier. I think there are very few actors of today who could even come close to reaching the pinnacle of acting that some of those guys that I just listed could ever achieve, in my opinion. Daniel Day-Lewis is probably the only one I would put next to any of them. And I like a lot of fucking actors. Don't get me wrong, I like a lot of actors. Daniel Day-Lewis is the only one who comes to mind. I think he could give Laurence Olivier a run for his money. This has just been my review of Inside Daisy Clover. Fucking watch it. It's wonderful. It's brilliant. It's well acted. It's well filmed. It is well written. I believe it's also based on a book. One of the most relevant films you could watch about Hollywood today. Thank you for watching. Live long and prosper. May the force be with you, and stay tuned and turned on for more. And technically, this wasn't entirely un-Star Trek related, because Christopher Plummer is in Inside Daisy Clover, and he's been in Star Trek. So, I really like Christopher Plummer. Obviously.